that you have made, so we shall be glad and rejoice in it. Father, we thank you for the shepherds of this household, Pastor Jerry and Pastor Charlotte. Father, we thank you that you've entrusted them with your word, with your grace, with your favor, oh God. And Father, I thank you that you continue to expand that influence, oh God. And I thank you that no good should be withheld from them in the name of Jesus. And Father, we thank you for the families that are here. Lord, have your way. Have your way, oh God, on tonight. Have your way on tonight.
Thank you, Lord.
Let it not be us, oh God, but let it be you
that's
speaking in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
So we yield all unto you right now.
Right now.
And we just give you praise. We give you glory.
Glory.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Amen. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you.
You know, one of the things, I think this is a wonderful thing that you all are doing, because one of the things that I have been prophesying and speaking prophetically was that the enemy was strategically attacking marriages, and he was going after the heads. He was confusing the heads. He was bringing in distractions and different things to discombobulate the head, to get out of position, to get out of line, and to get out of order, which is the will of God. And so there has been very specific things going forth like never before. Divorce rates, even in the house of God, outside in the world. And we're talking about being fit for our marriage. That means you're ready to work out. That means you're ready to endure. That means you're ready to lift heavy weights in the spirit realm. You know, there are things that have to be done. One is crucifying the flesh. One is acknowledging God as King and as Head.
Yes.
One is that acknowledging that you don't know everything. You don't have everything figured out. And this is for the man and the woman.
Yes.
Because what God wants to see in a marriage is humility. Because he said, and with humility, he gives grace to the humble. He will exalt that, which if it's in your marriage, that means he's going to exalt your marriage. But if pride is in the way, then that means that it's going to go to a low place. Now, you can allow pride to sit in, or you can decide to destroy that thing at the root. It's up to you. But God is challenging us in this season. And one of the, you know, when we think about marriage fitness, I was meditating and just really listening, and we came up with a scripture that I really, we really want to dive into and break down. If you have your Bibles with you, we're in Luke chapter 13, verses 6 through 9. Now, when you read this scripture, you really don't, these scriptures, you really don't think of it in correlation to marriage. But the revelation and the wisdom that God has given us for this pertains particularly to marriage. In Luke 13, verses 6 through 8, it says, "Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, 'For 3 years now I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?' 'Sir,' the man replied, 'leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, cut it down.'" So, in this parable of the fig tree, we have the owner of the vineyard, we have the manager of the vineyard, and then we have the tree itself. The owner is disappointed in what he sees with that he has given to the manager. The manager is being called out for not taking care of the thing that God gave him. Now, the tree is that dysfunctional place that needs attention. Y'all see where I'm going? So if the owner is God, he's looking for the manager of the marriage, and he's going to call out the manager or managers of the marriage for it not being where it needs to be, then there are things that needs to be addressed. The tree represents that place where it's not being fruitful, not multiplying, not doing what God had purposed for it to do. So we have the setup here in a parable of a fig tree, but we're going to relate and tie this in to marriage. Amen? So y'all are following us so far. Now, he said to the man that took care of it, for 3 years. Three prophetically means what? Completion. Three is also a number of completion. For 3 years, something should have been done. Something should have been completed within this vineyard. But as the manager is looking, as the owner is looking, he said, for 3 years, ain't nothing going on here. So you just going to keep letting it be like it is? Because if that's the case, we're going to plug it up. And he said, I've been looking for fruit, but not just any fruit. I've been looking for good fruit, and I haven't found any. This is where we have to look, and we have to challenge ourselves. If the owner of the marriage came in today, what type of fruit would he find? Would he be pleased with the managers of the vineyard called our marriage, or would he be upset? He said, why use the soil? In other words, why waste the time of the soil if it ain't gonna do right? Because whether you know it or not, the soil has purpose. So if you're not going to use the purpose for why it was planted, why even do it anyway? Why put yourself in that position anyway? So the owner is challenging the manager. So we see that the manager had an expectation of what the tree should look like. The owner had an expectation of what it should look like, but when he came, he found something totally different. See, the expectation is what God is looking at you for. So whether you're married or whether you're planning to be married, God is looking at you as the managers, because man and woman, woman wasn't called to be in front or behind. Woman was called to walk beside the man, hand in hand, to help. So if we're called to walk hand in hand in a marriage, then if God comes back and look at the managers whom he pulled one from the rib and called them a helpmate. So if I'm not helping my mate manage the vineyard the correct way, then what am I doing? If he's not helping me manage the vineyard the right way, then what are we doing? We're making the owner mad. We're making him displeased, and we're making him upset that he even allowed us to put it in soil, which is called covenant. Covenant is something that should be cherished and not broken. Covenant is something that you have to take for real, because God is a God of covenant. And if he put your marriage in his soil called covenant and you're not keeping it, then what are we doing? Stirring up the anger and the frustration of God. So that's why we have to really work this thing out and keep it fit and focused on what God has given us to do. Now I'll say this before I let my husband come in. The expectation foundation of the tree, as we said, was called your marriage. And the manager, which is God, who is looking to see what he's looking to see your harvest. So you have to really take out your microscope or whatever it is and look at the harvest of what God has given you. And when you look at your harvest of what God has given you, you have to be honest about what you see. The biggest judgment, the hardest judgment, I would say, to do is self-judgment. You know why the hardest judgment is self-judgment? It's because we're so quick and easy to shift blame. Just like Eve in her vineyard, in her garden, she was quick to shift blame, or Adam was quick to shift blame. Well, it's that woman you gave me. Well, it's that serpent. I mean, but did they ever one time just look at them? The hardest thing in a marriage or in life is self-judgment, because we are such good blame shifters. And we have to check ourselves before we wreck ourselves in this thing called a marriage, which is the tree that is planted in God's soil called the covenant, before we break it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I want to start out by asking you a question. How many people here love God?
I do.
How many people here just want to please God?
I do.
Is your behavior in your marriage edifying God? Don't
say
that.
Say
not. Think about
it. Is your behavior in your marriage edifying God? When people look at you and your spouse, do they say, man, I want that? Or do they say, man, I don't want no part of that?
Come on.
My wife just talked about. She talked about being managers, and that's one of the things that God has really been dealing with me about in the last few months. How a lot of times we ask for more stuff, we ask for more things, but I believe that the key, a kingdom key to having more, is being a good manager. Mm-hmm. I believe the kingdom key to having a better marriage is managing the marriage. That's Bible. I was reminded of the parable of how we said that, talked about the parable of the sower, how one man had two and one had five and one had one talent, and the one who had two managed it well, and it was multiplied 100%. One who had five, he managed it well, and it was multiplied 100%. And the one who didn't manage it, what he had was taken from him. And so the principle is God will always give more to a good steward, a good manager. And I believe that, you know, if we manage our house well, if we manage the marriage well, if we manage our time well, if we manage those things well, then we'll have that kingdom marriage. So is your behavior edifying God? Is your behavior edifying God? One of the things that my wife talked about earlier, we talked about marriage exercise. You guys know me, I'm an exercise guru, and I'll quickly talk about three types of exercises, and one of those is aerobic exercise, and this is when exercise gets your blood flowing and your heart pumping, you know, like jogging and exercising. And truth be told, that in our marriage sometimes we got to be able to endure some things, so we got to be able to endure some things. We got to be able to run a little bit. Everything is not going to be pretty. The second one, it talks about strength exercise. And this is, you know, a lot of times you're lifting the heavy weights to get your muscles bigger and stronger, and you're doing all these things. And reality is that sometimes you may have to tote the load in the marriage. Sometimes it's just some heavy stuff going on. And you got to be able to endure. You got to be able to carry the load, because it's not going to always be pretty.
That's right.
And the third one is flexibility training. This is when, you know, you're stretching and your muscles are able to bend a little bit and all this kind of stuff. And sometimes in marriage, you just got to bend a little bit. You can't be dogmatic about everything.
Oh, well.
Can't be your way every time. Can't be your way every time. I'm going to look over here. I see something over there.
We in church. We are the best.
Because reality is, you know, we talked about it, that God called them to be teammates. So he called them to be a helpmate and to walk by each other and to help each other and do all these things. And here's a key. In Genesis 2 and 20, let me find this one right quick.
Amen. Thank you.
It said that when God, you know, when God put the first union together, when he put Adam and Eve together, and God was creating, and it said that that Adam and God did all these things. He joined the animals and he did all these things. It said, but to Adam was not found a suitable mate for him.
Right.
And that's the word you got. And that's a curse word you got to get. It says somebody who was suitable
that's
for
good,
him.
That's good.
Sometimes we just in a situation that. Same thing. So,
come on.
And you know, I exercise a lot, and I have people come to me all the time, and they say, "Hey, I want to do those type of exercise you got because I want to look like you." But what I do may not be suitable for you, so you may not get the results that I get.
Yeah.
And sometimes we get joined to things.
Oh my.
Because they look good. Because they smell good, and I just love them. But the Bible says when God put Adam and Eve together, she was suitable for him. She was suitable for him. I'm going to leave that alone.
Talking good. Talking good.
I'm just talking.
Amen. Suitable. Suitable ties into being a good manager of knowing what is needed and what is not. What you want and what you need are totally different things. You have to manage or be a good manager of what God gave you. You have to apply wisdom, knowledge, and revelation. Going back to the vineyard, are you focusing on the harvest that is needed for a healthy and fruitful marriage? You know, he could talk workout all day long. But the workout has, what if you don't have a gym and all you got is a vineyard? You got to work with what you got. You got to work where you're at. Because everybody ain't a gym rat. But when you're in the vineyard and God has said your tree is not being fruitful, that means you got to go back and you got to work it out. You got to go back and you got to put in the work. So we look at the man that was put in charge of the vineyard. It was like, listen, everything around the man was good. business, your everything else is good, but when you go home and you got all this junk, but you ain't ready to work out in the vineyard, but you're ready to work out in your 9-to-5. You ready to work out with mama and dad and them when they need sister, brother, cousin, but when you, or even in the church, you working it out, you working it out, but when you go home, see, all the other trees was fruitful and multiplying. All the other trees was producing a harvest. But when he went home, there was this one tree. And because of that, see, the owner could have said, man, the whole vineyard is looking good. I'm proud. Even though you got one thing, this one thing that's not working, I'm proud of you. No, no, no. He looked at that one thing as a thing of importance and said, no, I am displeased with this. So everything else around you can be good. But you got to make sure that one thing that God put you in charge of is where it needs to be. See, the man he put in charge, he put them in charge of the marriage, I mean the fig tree. He knows that he has made God angry about the fruit that had been produced from the seed, which was no fruit. So here's the thing. You have to understand when you have disappointed God in your marriage. You have to understand when you have not been watering your tree. You have to understand that it takes humility to see what you've been doing, what you've been saying, the way you've been acting. If it ain't working, you got to be humble enough to say, that ain't it. The man, one thing about the manager in the vineyard, he acknowledged it in humility. And he asked the manager to give him another chance to get it right. Asked it. He said, give me another chance to get it right. He said, you know what? I'm going to dig around it. I began to fertilize it. And you got to understand this. This is your workout. Right here, when you got a tree that ain't fruitful, you got to dig. You got to sweat. You got to go deeper. You got to get to the root of some things as to why you acting the way you are. Why y'all not being fruitful? Why y'all not multiplying? You got to put in the work to figure out what is the root, because you can look at the leaves all day long and you see no fruit, but you got to get to the root. It's something down in the root of the problem. Is it a generational curse of divorce that's hanging over your head? Is it something that mama or daddy did, didn't do, was there, wasn't there? What is down at the root when you began to work it, when you began to figure out why you so mean? Why you so hateful? Why you so caught up in your own self that you can't even see how I feel? What is it about you that you shift the blame? Well, that woman you gave me. Well, that man you gave me. Well, what is it about you that when you dig deep and you begin to fertilize it, that you're going to find? See, here's the thing. The man began to cultivate that was given to him. He said, I'm going to cultivate my marriage. I'm going to cultivate it properly. I'm going to cultivate my wife. I'm going to cultivate my husband. What does it mean to cultivate? I'm going to do something that's going to promote growth within them so that it can promote growth within me. Because listen, whether you know it or not, you feed off of their growth or you feed off of their non-growth. So their negative energy is going to bounce on you, and now you acting the same way they acting because ain't nobody promoting growth in the marriage. Everybody is caught up in self and how I feel and what I need and what you doing and what you ain't doing, that we so caught up in that we can't even dig. We can't cultivate the soil that God put this thing in. Why are we not cultivating it? Good. One thing that I know is that it'll work if you work it.
Amen.
It will work if you work it. Instead of not dealing with the disappointment of no growth, you have to make up your mind, no, we're going to deal with this today. No, we're going to have a moment today. No, we're going to talk today. And we're going to lay aside every weight called pride, every weight called attitude, every weight called you frustrated on your job and you bringing it home to me, every weight called financial distress, every weight, we're going to come and we're going to have a come to Jesus meeting about the weight that you have been carrying, but yet you've been silent about. And you've been silent about that, but you've been loud about your attitude. See, the attitude is just the fruit that ain't fruitful from something that is deeply embedded in the root. And until you begin to work the soil, cultivate the soil, water the soil, dig deep and pull up every weed, every stumbling block that's down deep, then you'll never be able to have a tree that is fruitful and prospering that will make that owner look at it and say, well done. You got to learn how to do the work. We have to do the work. It's a workout. And workouts can be tiring, grueling, challenging, but it'll work if you work.
Talking about a tree, and we're talking about digging around, we're talking about doing all these things, watering it. And just like it's natural laws and physical laws, there's also spiritual laws. If you jump off top of a building, you're going to fall. It's a natural law. And those spiritual laws apply to our marriage as well. You know, Romans 3:27 talks about the law of faith. Galatians 6 and 7 talks about the law of sowing and reaping. Genesis 8 and 22 talks about the law of sowing and reaping. It says as long as the earth remains, there will always be seed time and harvest time. And spiritual laws apply to our marriage as well. You know, in Psalms 1 it says, Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And his law do he meditate day and night. He says he should be a tree planted by the rivers of waters that bears fruit in its season, and its leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Now here's what I want you to see, that in the natural, that roots grow naturally, they will always gravitate towards water. Naturally. And what he's talking about in Psalms 1, he says, he should be like a tree planted by a rivers of water. Now, if you plant it by a rivers of water, and the roots are gravitating towards water, that means that you got an unending supply of growth.
Oh my God.
But it's because you're being nurtured.
Yeah.
That's a spiritual law. A lot of times, my wife was talking about, a lot of times we want change. This is what I talk to, when I talk to guys, this is what I always tell them. Most of the time when we want change, the first thing we do is we look external. Who can I change or what can I change? Who can I change or what can I change? But reality is, truth always takes place internally first. When you change, everything around you changes. You change, everything around you changes. I'm going to change so we can be better. You change, you get better so we can be better. But most of the time what happens is I want to change you. So reality, we're saying, God, you don't know what you're doing. You created her. Transparent moment, I'll never forget. We were staying in Panama City. Me and my wife used to get into these little spats and arguments and stuff like that. And I can remember exactly where I was standing. I was standing in my front yard, right on the sidewalk, and I was praying to God. I said, God, you need to change that woman. You need to change. You need to do something with her. She is crazy. And was speaking to me. And I was praying that prayer, and God said, what about you? And I said, what? No, seriously, I said, what? He said, what about you? He said, if you change, then everything else will change. And quite honestly, for me, that's when I really got into, you know, me being better, me being self-developing, me growing. And when I got in position, my house got in position.
Come on.
When I got in order, then she got in order. Because here's you, it's nothing worse than if you got, I use the example, you got a wife or a woman who's operating at a high level, and you got a man who's operating at not such a high level. She's frustrated because she's in a position that she probably really is not anointed to be in. And not that she can't do it, but God has a God of order. And the man, what do you know now? See, we're men. You don't have to tell us when we ain't doing things right. You don't have to tell us when we wrong. You don't have to tell us when we ain't in position. We may not say, but we know. And we frustrated too. We are.
That's real.
That's a nugget. That helps somebody. So when he ain't doing right, you ain't gotta keep talking to him and tell him. He already know. He already know.
And just to, for you to understand what he's saying was when he's saying, I was called to be in a position that I was anointed to be in, meaning that I had to take up his slack and try to do things for him or be that for him or take cover up for him not being who he needed to be. But God never anointed me to be him, the man of the house. God anointed me to be the woman. But I'm trying to cover woman and man because he's out of position. And what that does is that brings complete frustration in your marriage. It brings complete frustration in the house because guess what? He can't be the man that he wants to be, that he know he needs to be. And that added pressure from the wife makes it even harder because she's not cultivating him. She's this to him. You see what I'm saying? There's a difference between cultivating a man and being in a man's face about everything. Because what this does is make him want to run. But when you begin to cultivate him, he will begin to grow and produce much fruit for you and y'all then. Amen.
Here's the second thing I tell the guys as well. You know, a lot of times we hear, you know, we hear the story about that Proverbs 31 woman. We hear that all the time. And I tell the guys this all the time. I said, fellas, she don't exist.
Come on.
You got to create her. Now you got to pull into her. You got to cultivate that. Like my wife said, you got to cultivate that woman to become that.
That's right.
If you want that. And that's what God has called men to do, to cultivate, to till the ground. So what we want to harvest to be, we gotta plant that.
That's right.
Yeah, we gotta plant that seed. And then we gotta water it, we gotta nurture it, we gotta do all these things.
Amen. So when you plant it, you gotta make sure that you realize what's at the root of what you planted. So we're going back to roots because a lot of times we see the fruit, but we ignore the root. What's at the root of your problem? Is it intimacy? Like, are you not being intimate as you should? And now there's some type of frustration with men because men, they are at a higher level than women a lot of times. And so you got to figure out how is it, what's at the root of this? Do we need to develop deeper intimacy with one another? Is it finances? Finances is one of the things that is one of the most common things that brings divorce in a marriage. Look at financial distress will cause people to go in two totally different directions. You know, when me and my husband was going through a lot of financial distresses, we never shifted blame. I never made him look like less of a man. Instead, I would encourage him, cultivate him, let him know, babe, you got this. We're going to make it through this. You can do anything. You can do this. You can do that. And it don't matter. We got to go through pork and beans and winter seasons because steak and potato is coming. I was prophesying to where we were going, yet I saw where we were at.
Yeah.
But where we were at, the root of it did not cause us to produce fruits of frustration, fruits of division, fruits of separation. We didn't divide our monies because you ain't making enough, and you and I, now you more of a roommate than you are my husband. And now we got division when it comes to finances because one may make more than the other, and we what we do is we set ourselves up for failure. And God says plainly in his word, a house divided will fall. If you are divided in your finances, how is it that you are going to prosper together as one? The root of the issue. You already planted a seed of division when we got married, you got your money, I got my money, and then we come together and we pay bills. That's a root of division that's already there. So you got to look at the foundation of it. Is it communication? A lot of times we don't know how to communicate because we've never been taught. We had bad relationships. Mama never got a divorce or mama never got married. But we saw men in and out of the house. Or daddy was very promiscuous. We never had an example of what healthy communication in a marriage look like. So at the root, you got to pluck that thing up and say, you know what? I got to learn. This is humility speaking. I got to learn how to communicate with my spouse. Because if I don't, we are going to go in two separate directions. If you don't communicate with them, then I can guarantee you somebody else will. And they're going to tell them exactly what they want to know, what they want to hear, and everything else. So what is the root? Is it that? Or let me ask you something. Has somebody broken trust? Meaning they stepped out, but God told you to stay. But yet you still at the root got all these trust issues, and you're reminding them of what they did. You're reminding them of when they did it. You're reminding them that they're the same person. Why? Because you got trust issues, and it may not even been them that stepped out. It could have been your daddy that stepped out, or your mama, and you saw that, and now you got trust issues at the root of your marriage because of what generations did before you, and you brought that in your house, and now you producing what? Unfruitful things in your marriage. You have to be able to get to the root. Women, are you intentionally affirming your husband about who he is? Are you telling him that he's the king, that he's your Lord, that he is this, that he is that? Abraham, Sarah called Abraham Lord. Because she knew who he was to her. Are you intentionally affirming? I make sure I intentionally affirm my husband. And if he don't say thank you, babe, I'll be like, babe, did you hear me? I just said, I want to make sure you heard me. Because I want to make sure that you hear me cultivating who I know you are. Showing gratitude for who I know you are. Being a blessing to who I know you are. So I'm going to speak to the king and not the fool. Because one thing that we was said that every man got two people on the inside of him. They got a king on the inside of him and they got a fool. If you talk to the fool, you're going to get the fool. But if you talk to the king, then you're going to get the king. I need the king to manifest right now. I don't need the fool, because the fool gonna make me be a fool, and now we two fools acting a fool. So where we going? Our vineyard is looking real dim right now. So this is where you have to really, really look at what it is you're doing. Generational curses are hovering over all of our lives. But it's up to us if we're going to let it take root and multiply on the tree that God told us to plant. I don't care what mama did or daddy did or grandpa, grandma, and what they doing now. That should have no effect on what God has called you to do.
Amen.
In your house, in your marriage, because that's yours. You got to take ownership of your marriage,
yes,
and you got to take ownership of your position in the marriage.
One of the things that she talked about was communication. So I just want to ask a question real quickly. I don't know. I just like to, you know, think about things. I'm reading Bible. What if Adam was a better communicator?
Right. Would Eve have even the reading? Yes.
What if he was a better communicator when the conversation was going on between
come on
serpent and Eve?
Yes.
What if he was a better communicator?
Come on.
What if he had stepped in and said, no, no. And sometimes you have to be careful of the seeds of doubt when other things are you let other people or other things that plant seeds of doubt. Did God really say? What if Adam had stepped in and said, yeah, God really did say that.
And been adamant about it.
What if he was a better communicator?
That's good, Pastor D.
And a lot of times, you know, it's not for every man, but you know how a lot of times we don't like communicating. We just shut down. But what if Adam had been a better communicator and not been closed mouth?
What if?
I mean, it didn't stop the plans of God, because God doesn't have a plan B. We know that, you know, and that's called a manifold wisdom of God. When you think you got something figured out, something else unfolds. I mean, Satan may have tried to hinder the plans of God. He always does, but it didn't stop it. I mean, when the man failed, that didn't stop the plans of God. It simply unfolded another part of something that God had already intended to happen. But what if Adam had been a better communicator? So all I'm saying is our communication has to be on point.
Yeah.
And again, you know, communication is, I know some of us don't know this, so I'm going to tell you a secret. Communication is a two-way thing. It's not one way. So, you know, one of the things I should say all the time, we have to be concerned about each other's concerns.
Yeah.
We have to be concerned about each other's concerns. Just because it doesn't matter to you,
right,
you know, just because it may be small to you and they think it's something big, we have to address it. Now, we can't babysit everything. But if it's a concern, then it needs to be addressed.
That's right. Amen.
Communication is very, very important.
And we're going to get ready to close out with a few things. Just some questions to ponder on. Can your spouse depend on you? Just think about it. In any area that you would jump over hills and mountains for them, can they depend on you? Are you always popping off with an attitude? Are you reliable? Are you bringing 110% to the table? Or 50-50? Are you distracted and unfocused? Are you spending more time on social media, work, friends, than you are in cultivating your own vineyard? Are you pulling your weight at the house? Are you expecting the wife or the husband to do the majority of the work? Are you being honest about your feelings? He just talked about communication. But if you're not being honest about the way you feel, then there's a miscommunication. Are there too many people in your marriage who are very opinionated? Are you making your spouse your best friend or your other best friend? Do your spouse know everything and anything that you need to share with them? Or do you go and run and tell that to your best friend before you tell it to your spouse? These are things that will help us cultivate the vineyard that God has given us. The tree, the one tree that the manager was led to really focus on. He was humble enough to say, you know what? God, you're right. Give me another year, and I promise I'll be the best manager of this vineyard that I could possibly be. Will you challenge yourself to go to another level of being the best manager of your marriage, co-manager, whatever, because y'all in this together? Will you challenge yourself in being that? Or you would just completely rely on the other person to do that? These are just some things to think about. Because you don't want all the other trees in the vineyard to outshine the one that's most important.
And I think the question I started with, is your behavior in your marriage edifying God? Is your behavior in your marriage edifying God?